Just a couple reminders real quick while people are still moving back and forth. Unit 13, just to the left of the Chinese restaurant, is open today. We're going to have it open every Sunday, every Wednesday. If you've got some stuff that you want to get rid of that's good quality for our upcoming mission sale on, I think it's June 11th. Anyway, it's just a bit into June. You can store it in Unit 13 just behind the building here. Again, the door will be open, so you don't need to go and get anyone. Just kind of open it and put what you got in there. Don't leave junk again. I have to stress that every time, because one year, 3 or 4 years back, we paid like a quarter of what we made in dump fees to get rid of stuff. But they actually threatened to penalize us for the number of old TVs that we had to bring. But anyhow, it's things just get imprinted into your memory. Reminder for mission teams coming up Tuesday night. This week is our meeting. Again, happy Mother's Day. On behalf of all the guys in here, happy Mother's Day. We'll just keep everyone from getting in any sort of trouble at all this morning. And my mother is probably watching from live stream. So happy Mother's Day, Mom. Love you. And with that, let's get into the Word. Father, we ask for your Spirit. We pray that we could be sensitive as we listen. Lord, as I listen, God, I pray that your Word would speak. Lead us, Lord. It's not my opinions. It's not the opinions of any man or woman in the room this morning, Lord. It's your heart, it's your truth, Lord, that matters. May we sit under it this morning. Lord, cause your Word to have such an influence on our hearts, God, this morning. Send your Holy Spirit to influence, Lord, our heart and our will, God, like no one can. Cause walls, Lord, to be lowered, defenses, Lord, to be put away. Holy Spirit, have your way with our hearts and minds this morning, Lord. Show us ourselves, Lord. Reveal Christ to us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go to Acts chapter 16. I had a message from 1 Corinthians chapter 4, which is where we're at in our chronology of the New Testament. And I felt like the Lord gave it to me extremely quickly because I had a lot of stuff to do this weekend. We were having home inspections because our house is under contract. We're selling and then getting the new place ready. I had a walkthrough. We did a missions car wash on top of that yesterday, and just been a busy week. But early yesterday morning, the Lord had given me the message from 1 Corinthians 4, which I was excited to share. And then last night, as I continued to ponder over it, I erased my notes on accident, which I have begun to do on a regular basis lately, either with my face as I fall asleep against my phone or with my finger. I don't even know how it happened. But when it happens, I have to pray, you know, at least to ask, God, is this a problem with me being clumsy and careless? Or are you erasing this because you want us to go elsewhere? And I feel a conviction that the Lord spoke to me through one phrase in Acts 16 this morning as I just tried to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit and where He would have us to go. And I do believe if we're willing to be led by the Holy Spirit, there are often directions that we'll set out in that the Holy Spirit will, even after we've made some progress going down that path, choose to turn us aside from. And I think that that may not happen with a lot of folk because it's easier to default to following a program than it is following the Holy Spirit. You don't get to look so good. You don't get to be in control. And all of those things that make people really comfortable and so forth when you're following the Holy Spirit. But the benefit of it is that God is glorified and you learn and you grow. And that's what we want. So Acts chapter 16. And we'll begin in verse 5. I'll give you a little bit of a kind of a preface here. The Apostle Paul's been doing ministry with Barnabas for a little while. And he's gone through in his first missionary journey and seen the Lord just do an amazing thing in the Gentile churches throughout the Greco-Roman world of his day. And the Gentiles are just coming to the faith in great numbers. The Lord had been using the Apostle Paul to do miracles, and those miracles would bring people's attention to the message which he preached, which was the centerpiece and the thing of importance. It's the message that he calls the gospel, which in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because it's the power of God that leads to salvation for all those who believe. And as the Apostle Paul would do these miracles, the attention of the people who were benefiting or who observed these would be turned to the gospel, and then mass numbers of people were being saved. And as they were saved, churches would form in all of the different cities that they went into, and the churches were very unsophisticated. They basically consisted of groups of people, however large, that came together, and because of their mutual faith in the Lord Jesus Christ having made them right with the Father of all creation, they were called the church. Their gathering of bodies together in unity around this belief in the Lord Jesus Christ is what made them the church. And that faith in the Lord Jesus Christ when they gathered together is what the Holy Spirit came and filled and entered into. And so they became, the people did, the temple of the living God on earth. And the temple in this day was no longer in Jerusalem. The temple in this day was wherever the people of God gathered, because that's where the holy place would be that God's Spirit would come and fill. And this was in fulfillment of John chapter 4 when the woman at the well said, hey, we've heard from our fathers that we're to worship on the mountain, and you guys, Jews, say in Jerusalem. And he said, oh, I tell you, a day's coming when they'll neither worship in this mountain nor in Jerusalem. For my Father seeks those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. And so in this day, in spite of the temple still standing throughout Paul's first missionary journey, the real temple of God was the bodies and souls of those that had given themselves over to God in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul had just seen this temple erecting by the power of God everywhere he went. The Lord Jesus, through his Spirit, was working through Paul and Barnabas to build this great temple that even in the Old Testament, we were told would one day be built by the Son of David, who would reign for eternity. Jesus, of course, who came in the line of David, was the one who was forecasted in those prophecies to come and do this. And we still have today, anytime we gather, the temple of the living God. And his Holy Spirit will come in upon our common faith and fill his holy place, you and I. And we in that holy place have this great privilege of fellowshipping with the God of the universe in the name of his Son. And this all happens. This is all given to us. This opportunity to have fellowship with God all rest upon the gospel. And that's why Paul says in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, because it's the power of God unto salvation for all those who believe. And we live in a day where I wonder if people even remember what the gospel is. And we live in a time where it's actually a legitimate question to ask whether or not the churches are actually preaching the gospel, but even more so, whether or not Christians are sharing the gospel. And so just think about that as we move into this text, and know as we read the first verse that we'll take up here, verse 5, that it comes on the back of Paul and Barnabas having met with the apostles in Jerusalem about what the gospel was. There was a question that had come as a result of some Jewish Christians that had come down to Antioch. Do we have to obey the laws of Moses to be saved? And it was settled in Jerusalem by the Jewish apostles and elders, no, we do not have to. Although we need to refrain from sexual immorality and idolatry, basically, we do not have to obey the law of Moses, for Peter had declared to them, we believe it is through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that we are accepted by God. And so a letter had been deduced as a result of that meeting, and Paul and Barnabas are now taking it through all of these brand new Gentile churches in order to securitize them in the faith, in order to affirm for them that the gospel that they had been preached was in fact the gospel, that what they had believed shouldn't be altered, thought about differently, in any way, shape, or form. The gospel was going to be affirmed by the letter. And so in verse 5, as they're delivering this letter, and we get the talk of that in verse 4, we come to verse 5 when this statement is made about the Gentile churches. So the churches were strengthened in the faith as a result of hearing this, getting the letter, having the gospel and what it really was affirmed. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and increased in number daily. Now these churches throughout the Gentile world, they had only very infrequent encounters with the Apostle Paul and the other apostles. They were very new. Paul and Barnabas, before they met Timothy, would eventually, after a short time, appoint elders in these churches. But other than some elder brothers, they had no real structure. They had the Holy Spirit and they had the Word of God that they had been taught, which in this day was called the Apostles' Doctrine. They were being taught to see the Old Testament rightly in order to understand that it all pointed to Christ. But that was what they had, the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, a group of elders to look to help guide them. And yet it says that the churches were strengthened and they increased in number daily. And I read this the other day, and I have to ask God, I said to myself, Lord, what are we missing? And I know everybody jumps to want to answer that question. Everybody has filled in the blank with something. And I can tell you that if it's a complicated answer or it seems like a secret, your answer is completely wrong. We're not really missing anything. The reality is we're just disobedient to God. Before Jesus left, he gave his last words in Matthew chapter 28, and he said, go into all the world. He said to make disciples of every nation, and we sit around and argue, oh, make disciples, that doesn't mean to preach the gospel. Like Mark 15 said, it's like his last words are different in Matthew 28 and in Mark 15. No, they're not different. The phrase make disciples in the book of Acts, it means to make converts by the preaching of the gospel. It doesn't have to do with teaching them and instructing them long term. It's a conversion phrase. It says that in the book of Acts, as they went through the cities and made disciples. Some of the cities Paul was in, he was there for 2 weeks only. The longest place he ever stayed was Ephesus for a couple of years. But in most cases, it was a couple of weeks to a couple of months. He wasn't leaving behind mature disciples. He was making disciples by the preaching of the gospel, and then he was leaving them in the hands of elders in order to grow and develop. Matthew chapter 28, the Great Commission, make disciples of all nations, is then followed with this instruction, teaching and commanding them to observe all that I've commanded you. That is the ongoing development. But the first order of business is make disciples. Also rendered in Mark 15, go into all the world and preach the gospel. That's what the Lord has called us to do. And then we sit around and to justify our disobedience, and I'm talking to myself included, we say, well, that was just for the apostles, or that's for the church leadership, or those that are gifted to preach the word of God. This also is a lie. This isn't true, because in the book of Acts, after Pentecost, when they all received the Holy Spirit, all 120 of them, and the Holy Spirit was a promise that Jesus said would come upon the church to aid them in being witnesses, in preaching the gospel. Well, after they received it, after a short period of time when the church had blown up and now was probably around between 8 and 10,000 people, a persecution broke out in Stephen's time. And as a result of the persecution, the Bible says all the Christians in Jerusalem were scattered except for the apostles. And it says they preached the word everywhere they went. The Christians preached the word, whether they were gifted in cleaning a toilet or in speaking. They gave witness to, they testified, and it wasn't hard to do, though it may have been somewhat scary. It wasn't hard to do for one reason. They had been affected, impacted by the gospel. Their lives had been changed by Jesus, so they didn't have to figure out what to say. They were excited and eager to share with people who they looked at and saw were like they were before they received Christ. Hey, I've got the answer. I've met Jesus Christ, the Messiah, my Savior. He set me free from the kind of life that you're living. I was estranged from God. I had the weight of sin on my life. And these guys came in and introduced to me this sweet news that God sent His only Son in the world to take my sin and pay for it on the cross in Jerusalem. And when I believed that, something supernatural happened. The very Spirit of the God who created all of us came to live in me. And all of a sudden, I didn't want to do the evil things that I'd always done. I began to change my desires, and the way I think began to change. I suddenly had peace. My heart was filled with new affections. No, I'm still a wreck. But I really am changed. My course is completely altered now. I'm following a different path, and every day I encounter through that Spirit I said was given to me, this God, and I actually have a relationship with Him. It's true. And they could proclaim this, and they could compel people, and they could plead with people through the gospel. And that is the only reason why this verse says, verse 5, numbers, and they increased in numbers daily, the churches. The churches grew without marketing. The churches grew without big budgets for entertainment. The churches grew without superstar preachers and worship leaders and iconic personalities because the Christians shared the gospel. They gave witness to what God had done in their life, and it became the most important thing. To be a witness for Jesus Christ became more important, and you'll disagree with it, but I can prove it to you from the scriptures 100 times over. It became more important for a husband than being a husband. It became more important for a wife than being a wife. It became more important for a father and a mother than being a father and a mother. Because the good news that they were proclaiming and the God that they were living for and the kingdom that they were looking for was what would make up all eternity. And they wanted to leave their spouses and they wanted to lead their children into it. And they wanted to exemplify what it looked to really look like to really be following Jesus. And their spouses and their children were 1,000 times better off for that kind of devotion to the Lord than our modern spouses and children are for the kind of devotion that we have. So often we withdraw from the one greatest, most overarching thing that God has given us to do for the sake of spouses and children, and we don't understand that most of the time, and I'm not saying you don't need to spend times with your wives and husband and your children, you certainly do, you need to be discipling them. But the way that you disciple your children is not to take 4 to 5 vacations a year and to drag them back and forth to Disney World and to spend all kind of money on giving them everything that you can. The way to disciple them is to bring them into your worship, to bring them into what you believe and what God has shown you, your revelation, and to bring them into ministry. I have such a great privilege of taking my kids, all of them, to missions. Caitlin, Nicaragua, D.C., New York, my two littlest ones, the 4 and 5 year olds, to D.C. every year of their life except for when they were first born. Every year. So that so many of the little kids here that are toddler age are less afraid to pass out a tract than adults are. And of course, kids don't have the same fear, but the point is we're bringing them into that. And listen, my little girls would never tell you that I don't love them. My greatest privilege with them is not dragging them off to a place like Disney World, even though I don't mind doing that. I actually like it myself. But my greater privilege is to tell them stories at night. After prayer, stories that in some way I can weave in the gospel, I can bring in spiritual truths because I want to indoctrinate them. Yeah, that's absolutely what I want to do. I want to shape the way they think. You say, oh my goodness. And the world acts like that. Oh my goodness, you're forcing these poor children into, if I don't do it with the truth, this rotten, scummy world will do it with lies and hypocrisy. And so if I have the truth, I want to do it with the truth. But so the whole churches, their children were being raised to believe this. There's nothing more important than sharing the gospel. There's a kingdom coming that will usurp everything that we know. There's a king coming who will put down all rule and authority. We're waiting for that day. This broken world that abounds with suffering, that overflows with all kinds of just hurt and pain and tragedy, isn't all there is. Praise God, we're looking for the celestial city. We're looking for the city whose builder and maker is God. There's something better. We're straining towards it. That's our faith. We believe, and so we'll lay our lives down for it. And if you don't believe it, yes, you're crazy for doing that. And so you can't go along with that if you don't really believe. If you've not been converted by the power of God, if it is only an intellectual thing, you think religion is good for society, like a gentleman that I talked to yesterday, why would you make any significant sacrifice? But if you believe that this world in its current form, as the Bible says, is passing away, and that only the Word of God will endure forever, and those who stand upon it, the rock that enables us to stand against the force of the storm, then why would you do anything else except stay anchored, stay secure, remain steadfast? But they grew in numbers. They increased in numbers because they were individually multiplying. They were all sharing the gospel. Now, that doesn't mean there weren't pockets of unfaithful people and pockets of really radical people. Of course. Of course there were. But their belief, their view of what it meant to be a Christian informed the whole church in this day in such a way as to think any differently would be foreign. And for them, just to have a moment to be invited into our modern history and to see how we do things would look so unusual to them, would look so foreign to them, that the gospel is placed into the hands of all, but the work of it is left to only a few, would look so foreign to them. Now, this is Paul and Barnabas. When they had gone through Phrygia and the region of Galatia, they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to preach the word in Asia. And after they had come to Mysia, they tried to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. And this was the beautiful thing, is that as they stepped out to be faithful to the commission they received from Christ to preach the gospel, the Spirit of God would go with them. And look how he's guiding them. They start to go into Asia. It's their direction. And somehow he turns them aside from Asia. He forbids them. They go through Mysia and they're ready now to go into Bithynia. And he forbids them. He won't allow them to go into Bithynia. He's faithful to guide them. This is in fulfillment of Matthew chapter 28. Jesus, after telling them to go and make disciples of all nations, commanding and teaching them to observe all I've commanded you, said, "And lo, I will be with you always, even unto the end of the age." That's how long the work was to continue. That's how long the commission that was given was to span, this current age of grace that we live in before the kingdom comes, before the judge stands ready to sentence. He said, "Lo, I will be with you always." And he really was, because the Spirit of God came on Pentecost in order to empower them to be witnesses. That's what Luke chapter 24 and Acts chapter 1 said. "Wait here in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from upon high." And they did, and they were. And then they began in obedience to preach the gospel, and lo and behold, Christ was with them everywhere they went, and he worked with them, doing amazing things so often, bringing supernatural conviction into the hearts of their hearers, doing miracles at times, signs, again, turning the attention to the gospel, hearts being convinced of the truth and the invitation that was being given to come to Christ, and mass numbers were converted. And here the Lord is guiding them. And verse 9 says, "And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, 'Come over to Macedonia and help us.'" So now the Spirit of God has said, "Hey, I don't want you to go here." And they've turned, gone a little distance, and he says, "No, I don't want you to go there either." That's normal. Anybody who acts like, you know, that guy who's got it all figured out, you're not really matching this real well. Because to be led by the Spirit is learning from the Lord, learning to follow. But the Spirit of God not only said, no, don't go here, but he says, go here. He grants that Paul has this vision, and he sees this Greek dude, from the man from Macedonia. He's a Greek, and in his vision, the guy's saying, come over here and help us. You know, and Paul's thinking like, where do I go, Lord? I tried to go into Asia and then tried to go into Bithynia. We just need to stop. And that night, God answers, come over here, Paul, Macedonia. And so he takes a cue, verse 10. Now after he had seen the vision, immediately, this is Luke who's narrating the book of Acts, by the way, we sought to go to Macedonia, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel to them. So now he knows where to go. He knows what to preach, and he knows where to go. Therefore, sailing from Troas, we ran a straight course to Samothrace, and the next day came to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is the foremost city of that part of Macedonia. So they end up in Philippi, a colony. And we were staying in that city for some days. So the Holy Spirit leads them to the place where he wants them to preach the gospel. And they set out, no doubt, and we'll see how things work out throughout this chapter, to do that very thing. Now, what is the gospel? Because we need to be reminded of that simply, in its simplest form. What is the gospel? Well, let's take a little walk around the scriptures, because I want us to see this. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Paul defines the edges of the gospel for us. He doesn't fill in all the wonder and the glory and the riches of it, but he defines the edges of the good news for us, what it mainly consists of. In 1 Corinthians 15, he says, moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you. In other words, what I'm declaring to you right now is nothing different than I preached to you in the beginning, which also you received. You received it. You believed it, Corinthians, and in which you stand. You're standing upon it. You're relying upon it. By which also you are saved, if you hold fast the word I preach to you. What does that mean? If someone says they believe the gospel, then suddenly they say they don't believe the gospel, they're not saved? Yeah, that's exactly what it just says. You say, what about once saved, always saved, Calvinism, Arminianism? None of that matters. The only thing that matters is what does the word say in black and white. Those who are born again, I believe from the scripture, they persevere in their faith. That's what the scripture teaches. God preserves them in such a way that they hold on to the faith. The Hebrew writer says, we are not of those who draw back unto destruction. But there are many who claim to believe the gospel that at some later point do not believe the gospel. They are not saved. They're not saved. They're not born again. You don't suddenly know Christ, and then suddenly you don't know Christ. You can become distant. You can begin to fall away. But you don't suddenly get to a place where you don't know him. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7 to people who might say such a thing, he says, no, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Yes, even though you claim you did some miracles and you spoke in my name, prophesied in my name, I never knew you. For I delivered to you, verse 3, for I delivered to you first of all that which I also received. In other words, this is what I received, this is what I believe. What is the gospel, Paul? That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. What does he mean, according to the scriptures? The entire Bible. The entire Bible. Every single book without exception, even the Songs of Solomon, is about Christ. Every single prophet, Moses, the five books of the law, it's all about Christ. From the very beginning, the first thing God says, let there be light. The light is Christ. It comes 3 days prior to God creating the sun. And then John, the first chapter, tells us that he was that light that illuminates every man coming into the world. Genesis 3, after the fall, when the Lord says to the serpent that the seed of the woman will crush your head, it's about Christ. Genesis 15, when God makes a promise to Abraham that through his seed all nations of the earth will be blessed, it's about Christ. All the way through the law and the prophets, it's about Christ. And the scripture made it clear with passages like Isaiah 53 and Genesis chapter 3 and many of the Psalms that Jesus would come and die. Daniel chapter 9, the Messiah will be cut off, but not for himself, murdered. Not because of anything he would do to deserve it. So he says, first of all, that Christ would die for our sins according to the scripture. And four, that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. He was buried. He went all the way. You know, in our modern culture, we'd say that they threw the dirt on the casket. It's done. He was really dead. The Muslims teach, as do others, that he wasn't really crucified. Some people teach that he only swooned, that he kind of passed off out on the cross and came to later. No, he died. He suffered the wrath of God and he died. And the Bible says that he descended into the lower parts. And he led captivity captive, all the souls of those who were in that resting place referred to in the scripture as Abraham's bosom. He took in the very presence of God as their redeemer, because his blood on that cross had paid for their sins. And now, because they were made white and ready to be brought into the presence of God, heaven was filled with their presence. So that now Paul would say that to be absent from the body for the believer is to be present with the Lord, because we're redeemed. So he died for our sins. He was buried. He rose the third day. Verse 5, and that he was seen by Cephas, Peter, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remained to the present. At the time Paul wrote that, most of them were still living. Verse 7, after that, he was seen by James, then all the apostles. And then last of all, he was seen by me also, as by one born out of due time, meaning he became an apostle later. For I'm the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But he encountered the gospel, and the gospel revolutionized him. The Spirit of God came into his heart and changed him on the road to Damascus and made him into a new man. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. What he's saying is, everything I am, everything I've become, I owe it to the grace of God. And the grace of God came to me through this gospel that I received, which you also received. And his grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was in me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, meaning whether it was me or those guys, those other apostles, so we preach and so you believe. You know what that means? This is what we preached, and this is what you believed. The gospel that I just gave you the corners of, the edges that I just described to you. It has never changed. Look with me at Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, after the resurrection, Jesus has been seen by Mary at the gravesite. And then there's two guys that are walking along the way, upset because their Messiah is dead in their minds. And he was the hope they had for the forgiveness of sin, and also that the kingdom would be restored to Israel, which they misunderstood vastly at that time. But listen in on their experience in Luke chapter 24, and let's look at how the gospel is represented here. Luke chapter 24, verse 13. Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day, the day in which Jesus rose from the grave, to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all the things which had happened, meaning that Jesus was crucified, those Romans took him in, the Jews, you know, condemned him and turned him over to those Romans and all that stuff. And he was buried, and they're very upset about this whole thing, and they're talking about it. So it was, verse 15, while they conversed and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained so that they did not know him. Verse 17, and he said to them, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad? And the Greek actually conveys that when he said, what kind of conversation is this you guys are having, that they stopped walking and looked down sadly. In other words, the idea is they were despondent because they don't understand the resurrection yet. Then one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? You've not known the things which happened there in these days? And he said to them, what things? So they said to him the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed in word before God and all the people, how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. This is what they'd been talking about. They were sad because of this. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today's the third day since these things happened. And they knew that Jesus had been saying that he would arise on the third day. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. They freaked us out. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. So these guys are perplexed. They're sad. They don't believe this, but their minds are all, they're reeling. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. And then he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? In other words, isn't this what the prophets wrote about concerning the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior of the world? Isn't this what God himself had said through those thousands of years through the prophets? Isn't this what your Bible talks about, that this would happen to the Messiah? That he would come and die and that he would rise again? Foolish of heart and slow to believe. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, look what he does. He explained to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Jesus began to preach the gospel to them using all of the Old Testament scriptures. Then they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone further, but they constrained him, saying, stay with us until toward evening, the day is far spent. And he went in to stay with them, and it came to pass as he sat at the table, he took bread, blessed it, and gave it to them, and their eyes were open. Isn't it interesting that their eyes would be open in the breaking of bread, that which represents the breaking of his body, the communion? Think about it. We've only got in Christianity two sacraments, communion and baptism. What do they both talk about? They both talk about the gospel. Communion is about the broken body and the shed blood. And Paul says we do this to show his death till he what? Comes. Why? Because he's resurrected, glorified, coming again. Communion is the reminder of the gospel that he died for us, his blood was shed, and that he's coming for us as a result again. And baptism reminds us that he was crucified, he was buried, he died and was buried, and he rose again. And that we who put our faith in him and what he did benefit from that in receiving new life, letting go of the old, laying our lives down, dying to the flesh in our old life, and receiving new life from Christ. The only two sacraments. They remind us of the gospel, the very centerpiece of Christianity, and their eyes are open in the breaking of bread. And look what happens. And he vanished from their sight. What's the point of that? That's a big underline, is what that is. That's the underscore. He could have vanished at any time. When does he do it? After the breaking of bread. I died for you, but I'm alive. I'm here. And then he's going to appear again. Look, verse 44. Then he said to them, "These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me." He had come into the room now with the disciples who were gathered, no doubt in fear. And it says, he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. The Lord has to do that for us because we can be blinded. And we can have this book in front of us, which cover to cover speaks to us of the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, makes it the Magna Carta, the very entryway into the kingdom of God. And yet somehow we can be blind to it and get on to something that distracts us and sidetracks us. So we begin to open their minds so that they could comprehend the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written, and thus it is necessary for the Christ to suffer and rise from the dead." That's what he showed them from the scripture. And that repentance and forgiveness of sin should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are his witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in Jerusalem till you're endued with power from on high. Jesus tells them himself, you wait in Jerusalem until you receive power from the Holy Spirit, and then you go preach what I've just enabled you to understand from the scripture. Go preach it. And that repentance and forgiveness of sins would be granted in my name. And what do? They go and do that. Turn with me to the book of Acts. Let's take a look at the very beginning with Peter. Acts chapter 3. Peter is preaching. This is the first sermon after Pentecost, when they had received the Holy Spirit. And we'll just cover a portion of his message. Verse 19. We'll back it up one verse. But those things, Peter's in the middle of preaching, those things which God foretold by the mouth of all of his prophets. You see the consistency. Jesus used all the prophets to show them the gospel. Jesus used all the prophets to show Cleopas and the other disciple on the road the gospel. And now Peter, he's gotten that. He understood it. Why? Jesus opened his mind to it. Luke 24. So through all the prophets that Christ would suffer, he is thus fulfilled. And then look what Peter's declaration is. Repent, therefore, and be converted. that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus Christ, who was preached to you before, whom heaven must receive until the time of restoration of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. They are preaching the gospel. They're preaching repentance. Those who say that we're called to preach the gospel, we're not called to preach repentance, do not understand the gospel. They don't understand the good news. The reality is, the good news is as a result of what Jesus did. And the Holy Spirit proclaiming that to a person, that God is now willing to change the heart and the mind as they hear this, producing a repentance, a contrition, and a brokenness over sin, and thereby, in that same moment, being convinced of Christ, that he's willing to save them, to receive them, to forgive them, and in that moment, they become saved. That's a kid's toy or a horn, because we don't have anything like that in the building. So don't be alarmed, no pun intended. And there are people who teach that. There's a guy right now, Ralph Yankee Arnold, and his predecessor on the radio. And they teach that repentance is not necessary for salvation. That is not consistent with what the apostles taught, and it's not consistent with what Jesus said. His first message coming out of Matthew 4 was, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. And the whole point of that was, repent, get ready. It's what John the Baptist was sent to do. Remember, preach repentance. He had a baptism of repentance. The idea is, get ready, the kingdom is at hand. That means the kingdom is here, and I'm going to grant you access to it. Okay, where's the access? What is the access? Let me get into it. My heart is repentant. God's granted me that. I want to get in. Door, I just need the door. Where's the gate? John chapter 10, I am the door. John chapter 10, I am the gate. It's the gospel. The gospel is the access into the kingdom of God. And so what are they all teaching? They're teaching the gospel, and part of that is repent. You see it filled in, beginning with John the Baptist, with the message of repentance, and then Jesus coming and saying the same thing, repent, for the kingdom is at hand. Then Jesus living a perfect life, dying for sin, rising again, so that now the people, through repentance and faith, can enter into the kingdom that is at hand. John chapter 3, Jesus had said to Nicodemus, unless you be born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. He had also said, unless you be born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. You can't perceive it. You can't avail of it. You can't partake of it. And how are we born again? Peter says, we're born again through the incorruptible word of God. We're born again through the word of God, which Peter says is able to save your soul. We're born again through the gospel. And so they go preaching the gospel in accordance with the commission of Christ, and numbers are added to the church daily because all of the believers are preaching it. Because they've become born again, they're citizens of the kingdom. They know what it is now to give everything up, to pursue the kingdom of God, the righteousness of God. As a result, they're being filled with joy. They're overflowing with peace. They have the security of God's love. They're forgiven. And they have the peace of now being forgiven, made right with God. They have the witness of the Holy Spirit that's just causing joy to overflow in their lives. The fruit of the Holy Spirit, love, joy, peace, etc., etc. And now they go as witnesses of this, and the numbers just increase. And it's all really very simple in one sense. Christ came and saved them, and now he tells them to go tell others what has been done for them. And the reality is, the Spirit of God is using what's been done for them as a living witness before people, because they're seeing a difference in their lives. They're so impacted, their lives are so changed that they're shining a light. They're like a city set on a hill. The quality of their faith and their life makes it so clear to people that don't have that peace and that joy that they really did get something. God really did do something. The Apostle Paul goes from this persecutor now to this humble man filled with love and brokenness for the church and for the world, and with a passion for God. This is the gospel. And in our day, I wonder, you know, what has the gospel come down to? This is a really simple statement of it. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I like this one because I think this is a good one for all the modern churches. It's a good one for me. It's a good one for you to remember. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Paul's just, he's talking about what a blessing it is that we've received this ministry. And he's talking about us, we, you know, we're all ambassadors for Christ. And he's comparing it to the ministry that the Israelites had under the old covenant and how it's so superior to that. And then he says in chapter 4, verse 1, therefore, since we have this ministry as we've received mercy, we do not lose heart. We don't give up. But we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, by making the truth known, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. They're living in such a way that is beyond reproach. That's the goal. People look at them, they look at their lives, they're not swindling people, they're not ripping people off, they're not raging on people, they're not ruining their testimony before they ever get to share the gospel. And as a result, people look when they hear the gospel and they're like, yeah, you know, I've been watching this guy and he really is not like me. He really is different. There is a quality about his life that really substantiates his message. And the Christians had that reality because the Spirit of God had changed their life. And it's not that they didn't make mistakes and need to repent and confess sin. Obviously they did. We get that instruction all through the New Testament letters to the churches. But by and large, the rule of their life was, man, God changed our lives through the gospel, through our relationship with Jesus, and we want to tell you about it. And then as people look, they're like, man, you know, it really does look like they've got something. You know, they didn't walk around the corner and then suddenly that smile that was plastered on their face was gone. Or they didn't walk around the corner and that passion they had gave way to them staring down that chick that walked, you know, across. Like somehow they really are changed. And the Holy Spirit uses that. But even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled hidden to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this world is blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. Here it's called the good news of the glory of Christ. I love how you can go through the scripture and you can get like these, you know, special, like superb titles of what the gospel is. And here he calls it the good news of the glory of Christ. In one place, Peter called it the gospel of God, the good news of God. Here it's the good news of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. He says, lest the light of the gospel is the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine upon them. In other words, the enemy's covered their eyes because he doesn't want them to see the truth. He doesn't want them to see God through the Lord Jesus Christ. And then he says, as a reminder, for we do not preach ourselves, man, but Christ Jesus the Lord and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. We're just your servants. We're not coming to preach ourselves. We're not blowing up our personalities. We're not putting, you know, my face, you know, out on a sign somewhere, or your face out on a sign somewhere. We're putting Jesus' name out there. I've been thinking a lot lately about, like, yard signs and stuff. I really have to, you know, just because of the position God has me in, I really have to think through that stuff, even stuff like our business cards. And I'm not saying by what I'm about to say that we shouldn't do things with excellence, but we have about the cheapest business card that you can get, and on the back of it is the gospel, actually what we read from 1 Corinthians 15. Because I felt like if we're even going to spend $50 to print 100 business cards, we better at least have Jesus on there and have the gospel on there so that through that expenditure, since it's God's money, someone can come to the Lord. When we did the car wash yesterday, the first guy, such a privilege to share the gospel with that guy. And I've said before, if that ruins, you know, our car washes or our mission sales or whatever, so be it. Who cares? Rather be broke and just share the gospel, then that means the Holy Spirit's turning us aside from whatever cost the money that we couldn't get. And I've thought about the yard signs because I see, you know, a lot of churches put them around. And I thought, yeah, that's a great thing. You know, if you believe you're a ministry that really has a message from the Lord that needs to be heard, and that you're available to disciple people, and there's a real church that comes together that's ready to love on people and disciple people and take people in, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But as I, you know, the more I thought about it, I thought the only way I'd be willing to do that is if we put the gospel on the yard sign, so it was like, you know, a big track in everybody's yard. And I'm not saying we're going to do that. What I'm saying is we don't have any business preaching our own names. We preach, Paul says, we preach Christ Jesus the Lord. Why? Verse 6, for it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, and who is shown in our hearts to give the light of the glory of God in whose face? In the face of Jesus Christ. So whose face is it? Whose face is on the ministry? Whose face is on your ministry? Who by and large is promoted? And it's not that the Apostle Paul is known. I mean, he wrote, you know, the majority of the New Testament, obviously. But who is he talking about? He's talking about the Lord Jesus. You go to the book that we're in. You don't have to turn there. You can turn back to Acts 16. But even the book we're in, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 and 2, tells us that when Paul came to Corinth, he said, I determined to know nothing among you except Christ and him crucified. The gospel is very clear, and the gospel is what is preached in the scripture, and the gospel is what we're called to preach, and the gospel is attended by the Holy Spirit. The gospel is what brings us into the kingdom. And as we grow in the Lord and as we begin to understand what it means to be a part of the kingdom of God, we never stop standing upon the gospel. Now, back in Acts chapter 16, they're in Philippi. Remember, because the Holy Spirit turned them aside from the other places. Paul saw the vision of the Greek dude. Hey, come over and help us. So we're going to fast track into this because the question has been asked, who was that guy in the vision? Some people have said, oh, it's the Philippian jailer. Maybe so, but the importance is the guy says, come over and help us. And so Paul gets into Philippi, and it's pretty cool, there's no synagogue there. It's a totally unreached place. There's not even a lot of men in, you know, Judaism that are really seeking the kingdom of God, looking for a Messiah, because he has to go down to the river in this city and meet with this gal, Lydia, which would usually be the place of prayer for the Jewish people in a city that had no synagogue, which meant there weren't even 12 men that were pursuing the Lord with enough vigor to have formed a synagogue. So they're meeting down at the river. He goes down to the river. He begins to meet with her. They're preaching the gospel in Philippi. You don't have to read through it, but verse 18 tells us they start to stir up a hornet's nest. A demon-possessed girl comes who's been reading everybody's fortune, making her owners lots of money in this city, very superstitious pagan city. And God has just like shot the Apostle Paul like an arrow right into it. And he's going to plant a church in this city. But he's going to go ahead and deal with these guys that are corrupting the city, that have this paganism and this occult practice going on. So this girl decides to follow Paul. Some of you remember the story. She's saying, "Oh, these men are the men who show us the way of the Most High God." But she does it every day, you know? Like she's trying to identify maybe with Paul's ministry. Like Simon the Sorcerer did. Remember, they thought he was the stuff until Philip came down and preached, and then everyone turned their attention from him. As soon as he saw them turn their attention, he was like, "Man, I better get the Holy Ghost too." So he asked Peter, "Can I buy that with money so that when I lay my hands on people?" And Peter flat out rebuked him. Well, the slave girls follow in kind of similar to that, saying, "These are the men that show us the way." Paul gets sick of it after, maybe a couple weeks passes. It says many days, turns on her and says to the spirit in her, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her." Well, now she can't tell the future anymore. The demons are no longer operable. God's come in and cleaned house. These guys are upset with the Apostle Paul. They come in. They're ready to beat him, throw him out of the city. Long story short, as a result of Paul's ministry there, he ends up in jail. Fast track through it. And then pick it up with me in verse 23. "And when they had laid many stripes on them, Paul and Barnabas, they threw them into prison, commanding the jailer to keep them securely." Now, to me, this is awesome because... And Ben, you guys can go ahead and come on back up, because I just want us to spend some time in worship thinking about this concept, because if we're going to be witnesses, we have to have experienced something that we can give a witness to. And it's got to be something that we're experiencing fresh. We're continuing to have an experience with Christ. Otherwise, if your witness, in one sense, replies on what God has done in your life, if what God's done in your life gets old, then you don't have a lot of fuel for your witness. So, anyhow, they get beat. They throw them in jail. Verse 24, "Having received such a charge, he put them into the inner prison, fastened their feet in the stocks. But at midnight, Paul and Silas," I said Paul and Barnabas, excuse me, "were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them." That is amazing right there. And I'll tell you why. Because unless, you know, Paul was a really good singer, you know, or Silas was, that's amazing. Because I know prisoners, I know convicts, I know murderers and rapists. I know them by name. I know them, lots of them, because I spent 9 years with them. And they don't really appreciate people singing in the middle of the night so that everybody can hear them. But especially some foreign religious song. And that's what they're hearing. But see, there's a quality in what they're singing. It's not their voice. It's not how well they do it. What they're singing has been animated by the Holy Spirit. And God is receiving this precious worship as the blood is just beginning to congeal from the beating that they took. And here they are, it's the middle of the night, and they're worshiping God, just so thankful that they were counted worthy to suffer for the Lord Jesus. I mean, don't you want an adventure like that? I'll be honest with you, it may sound ridiculous. I don't want to get beat, but I want to be in the middle of it for Jesus. I'm ruined for everything else. Everything that this world has, it's not happening for me. And if you've tasted the Lord at all, it's not happening for you either. I want to be in the middle of it with him. There's not a vacation. There's not a Disney World. And I'm not saying don't take a vacation. But there's none of it. There's not a sexual experience. I mean, I'm just being real with you. There isn't anything like being in the middle of it with Jesus and having the presence of the Holy Spirit. Why are they doing this? Because they can be bloody. They can be in prison. And as long as they've got Jesus, lo, I will be with you. And just as he promised, oh, he's going to be with them. Check it out. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open and everyone's chains were loosed. To me, this is awesome. And I think, just as the Bible says in the Old Testament, that God heard, he told Moses, I've heard the cries of my people coming up from Egypt, and I've come down to see. And that's why I'm sending you to deliver them. I think that when Paul had that vision, that the Spirit of God in the form of this Macedonian man was articulating the heart's cry of all of these lost prisoners. And we'll see too, of the Philippian jailer, who I think is probably just miserable, at a dead end in life, none of these guys having any hope, and suddenly they begin to hear something, and it's hopeful. It's the sound of heaven, even though it may be coming through two men that can't sing a lick. It's the sound of hope and life and something different, and they're listening, but then all of a sudden, man, there's an earthquake, things are rattling, and the cell is open. Now, what do you think is normally going to happen? They're gone. They are gone because most of them probably are going to die. They're in the inner prison. That means they're in lockup. They're in confinement. They're in FSP. They're at the Rock. If you know anything about the Florida State Prison, they're in Union, where the death chamber is. But the keeper of the prison, awaking from his sleep, seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners has fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. What's this guy going through? He's not even going to check. He just sees the doors open, and wherever he's at in life is such a state that, man, that's the camel, that's the straw that just broke the camel's back. That's the icing on the cake. That's the last straw. That's it. I'm just ending it all now. And I think the sense here is this guy has been ready to do this. This guy is miserable. This guy lives in fear. And I've thought about all the COs that I've known throughout my time in prison. And I watched in their sexual scandal, marriages break up between the COs. They're no different than the prisoners. They're just broken people. And I know this guy, he's no different. He's just on the other side of the bars. He's a broken, lost man who's part of the cry that the Holy Spirit sends out to the Apostle Paul. And if you just imagine that, you want to know God's will. You're sensitive to the Lord. And that the Holy Spirit, that God Almighty, on behalf of lost people, would speak to you. Come on over here. Help us. That's what I feel when we go to Gasparilla and drunk people scatter the streets. And that's what I feel in D.C. And that's what I feel in Guavaween. I feel like the Lord is giving articulation to the broken, lost hearts of people who don't know their right from their left, like God said to Jonah about the Assyrians. Wicked Assyrians. And God had compassion. He loves the people in this prison. And he loves the Philippian jailer. And he's about to kill himself now, but Paul calls out in a loud voice and says, don't do it, man. Maybe he hears the sword, I don't know. Do yourself no harm, for we're all here. And look what the guy does, because, you know, every time I've read through this passage, I've circled earthquake. Yeah, do that, God, when I worship. Do that. The whole place was shaken. Maybe put a box, you know, a yellow highlighter around it. All, especially as an ex-convict, all the prison doors were open. Yeah, that's great. But I've never circled until I believe this morning the Holy Spirit did it for me. These words from Paul. For we are all here. Man. See, the Spirit of God was already working in these prisoners. He's already working in the Philippian jailer who's at his wit's end. And he's done such a work that before they even hear the gospel, he's already readied their hearts. He's already begun to change their heart. Listen, the moment the gospel, think of it, here's a heart that any given opportunity, they would have ran right out of that prison. But now the work of God through the Holy Spirit is such that the doors are flung open. They have prayed for this. They've looked for it. They've tried to conspire to make it happen. And here it is. The doors are open. And they're not going anywhere because God just freed them in their hearts. That is a heart that is fertile soil. And Paul is about to take precious seed. And that seed's going to hit that soil. It's going to hit that Philippian jailer. We won't even go any further in it. You can stand with me as we begin to worship if you want to kill that light. That seed is going to hit that soil. And what's going to happen is immediately, because the life of God is resident within that heart already, it's going to take the gospel and it's going to sprout into life. The Philippian jailer is going to be so struck by this. He's going to pull Paul and Silas out. He's going to wash their stripes. He's going to take them out of the jail. If he couldn't have died, if he couldn't have been executed for, you know, the doors open, the prisoners escape, he could definitely be for this, but now he doesn't care anymore. He's not living in fear anymore. Everything has changed. Paul speaks a prophetic word to him because he says to Paul and Silas when he sees this, what lost people can say under the Spirit of God's power, sirs, just tell me what I have to do to be saved. What must I do to be saved? And they make it so simple. Believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you and all your house will be saved. And that was prophetic, because God was doing work in that city. Man, here's what I'm saying to you. If we as a church listen to the Lord, and we endeavor to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, he will lead us to places where he's been working in the hearts of the people. He will. And when they hear the gospel, life will spring forth right in front of us. That is such a great privilege. It's what God has called us for. It's why we still draw breath. It's why we haven't been taken into the celestial city. It's why we're still on planet Earth. If we're willing to recommit to doing this one thing that God has called us to, you talk about wonder, adventure, amazement, glory, joy, peace. Lo, I'll be with you always, even to the end of the age. It's there for us. Not many are going to do this. And I fear that not many in America, especially until things get so bad, when it's so clear that the time is short and that there's nothing else more important than this, that they finally are pushed essentially to a place of willingness. But we don't have to wait. We can enter into this now. And it's what the Lord wants, I know that. So let's respond to Him now just in a few.